Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Diversity Intelligence, How to Create a Culture of Inclusion for Your Business by Heidi R. Andersen. Narrated by Jennifer Aquino. Publisher's Note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures, charts, and tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Foreword. I am a white, heterosexual, cisgender male. My diversity footprint is not just small, it is virtually non-existent. I could hardly be more privileged. Even if I tried not to be, a patriarchal and racist system would reward me anyway, simply for being who and what I am. Acknowledging and understanding my privilege, dealing with its consequences, and deconstructing its negative effects on different social groups has been a big challenge for me. Yet, that is nothing compared to the challenges of the non-privileged or marginalized who must face and deal with systemic discrimination every day. The debate around white male privilege and my own challenge to grapple with it are key to understanding and changing the paradigms of exclusive systems and organizations. Only by understanding such systems and their underlying hierarchies can we gradually overcome toxic normativity and lift the burden we force on people who are different from our norms. One of the pivotal moments in patriarchal societies, for instance, is when men become aware of their privilege. Once we are able to acknowledge that we have had a veritable head start simply by identifying as male or white, we slowly begin to grasp and examine the consequences of our privilege. We need to understand how our own socialization within patriarchy has affected our behavior, and how that behavior in turn has consequences for us and the people around us. The tough thing about privilege is that being privileged does not necessarily feel so great. Privilege is the absence of inconvenience, an impediment, or challenge. When you have it, you don't really notice it, but when it's absent, it affects everything you do. What psychologist and former NBA player John Amici says is the very reason privilege, and especially the unawareness of it, stands in the way of truly creating inclusive systems. Systems in which each and every one of us can unfold their full potential without having to deny certain aspects of their personality or character. Such systems, however, do not yet exist. Instead, we foster normative societies and organizations in which only certain social groups feel like they belong, while others are left out. And even worse, the cognitive load of constantly having to adapt to circumstances that do not meet one's own needs is one of the major obstacles for belonging. It drains a lot of energy from people from the out-group. The playing field is not level, so one group always has to work harder than the other. Many privileged people, however, do not feel the need to create more inclusive systems. That does not necessarily make them bad people. They just do not realize that the core of privilege is that a problem isn't perceived as a problem because it isn't your problem. Many people do not understand the role they play in the harmful practice of marginalization and discrimination. Instead, they believe that they are about to lose something. For someone who is accustomed to privilege, equality feels like oppression. The absence of privilege, on the other hand, leads to systemic imbalances regarding access for people who are not part of the privileged in-group. Therefore, we need to understand people's access to our systems. What does the world look like for someone who is non-white, trans, homosexual, poor, disabled, illiterate, introvert, and or else? How does our world feel for others, for people who are different from us? people who are different from us, is a quite accurate definition of the concept of diversity, which goes way beyond the binary and narrow debate of male versus female. We are so much more than just men and women, black or white, disabled or able-bodied. We are complex human beings living together in complex social systems. Thus, a debate about how we want to live and work together without understanding the concept of intersectionality is impossible. Kimberly Crenshaw, distinguished professor of law at the UCLA School of Law, who introduced and developed the concept of intersectionality, describes its impact as follows. It's basically a lens, a prism, for seeing the way in which various forms of inequality often operate together and exasperate each other. We tend to talk about race inequality as separate from inequality based on gender, class, sexuality, or immigrant status. What's often missing is how some people are subject to all of these, and the experience is not just the sum of its parts. Before we can embark on a journey towards inclusion, we need to acknowledge the systemic experiences of different social groups as well as the interdependency of their social features. We need to understand how intersectional setups define whether a human being has access to our systems or not. And the key to understanding that difference in access is empathy. Diversity is a fact. Inclusion is the path. Belonging is the goal. For many people, this is already a paradigm shift. They still believe in some kind of diversity endgame. That explains why so many organizations are currently jumping on the bandwagon by bragging about their diversity initiatives. But what they are actually doing has little to do with a fundamental change of systemic frameworks. Instead, they are feeding their own culture gaps. Organizations can be privileged, too. It's the privilege of interpretation many companies claim for themselves. They interpret their own approaches towards being fair and inclusive far too optimistically. One might call that practice pinkwashing, adding to what organizational change theorists call the culture gap. The gap between the culture as intended, CAI, and the culture as practiced, CAP. This gap between talking and doing can become very dangerous for an organization. Once the gap becomes too big, companies can implode. Many companies still believe in the tail of the pipeline. They think that just by adding women or POC to their pipeline, the whole system will change. But representation does not automatically lead to participation. Quite the opposite is the case, actually. If all we do is add people from the diversity drawing board, we are throwing these people under the bus. Organizational cultures often work like an immune system. They attack every outsider who does not belong. Inclusion is hard work, especially because diversity itself can be very demanding, exhausting even. Not only do we have to overcome our biased assessment of people and circumstances, we also need to find intrinsic motivation while doing so. Extrinsic metrics alone, however, are not enough to change the practice of unconsciously installing and upholding exclusive, in-group-oriented monocultures. At some point, we need to believe in what we are doing. Apart from financial or political aspects, we need to embrace the idea that it is the right thing to do to create systems based on equal opportunities. Our KPIs should not be awards or manifestos or quantitative metrics from the pipeline only, but a feeling of belonging for those who have not yet had equal access. Our approach to understanding these facts and putting the necessary steps in motion must be an empathetic one, not just a rational one. We need to educate ourselves and learn about our conceptual biases, such as intersectionality and privilege. DEB, diversity, equity, belonging, is nothing less than empathy training. It can be very challenging. It also needs a humble perspective by those who are already part of the in-group. But the result is worth every effort. The key to change is a process of reflection for men, because men are holding positions of power. And with power, there comes responsibility. We need to become aware of our privilege, especially if we do not feel or experience it. If we feel accused, neglected, or blamed by all those attempts to heal a sexist, misogynist, exclusive, classist monocultural system, then we still have a lot of work to do. We are key players in that process. We need to become allies in changing the system. We need to live up to our responsibilities and play a role as agents of change. We need to identify how, when, and where our behavior harms people who are different from us. Then, and only then, can we enable our organizations and our systems to become truly inclusive. Robert Franken is a German consultant, speaker, and activist. He advises organizations and top executives on the subjects of transformation, DIB, and organizational change. Now an expert for organizational culture, Franken used to be the CEO of various tech and community startups. He is on the advisory board of Panda, a German network for female executives. In 2016, he founded the platform Male Feminists Europe. He is one of six honorary catalysts for He for She Germany. Introduction. I would like to start by telling you why I am writing this book. Diversity and inclusion, D&I, is an area that I am incredibly passionate about. Through this book, I want to help more companies enhance their ability to stay in the market by implementing D&I initiatives that work. I want to improve well-being and psychological safety in workplaces, and I want companies to become more innovative by attracting and retaining talent, no matter what that talent looks like, and to benefit financially from it. Most of all, I want this book to help many more companies harness the many benefits of diversity and inclusion. As we at the Living Institute have discovered, the best way to do this is by developing what we call diversity intelligence. In this book, I will share why diversity intelligence can foster an inclusive culture in your organization, one that attracts, motivates, engages, and retains the most talented people you can possibly find. You will learn all the key steps to take and those to avoid, and I will also share how to get others on board to create the necessary mindset shift. But first, let me take you back to the time when I first realized how diversity affected me. Cake, licorice, and an unfortunate Danish company. I have been living and working in a diverse setting my whole life. Even as a child, I realized that a person's cultural background has a big impact on norms, values, and behaviors. My mother is a Danish Lutheran, and my father is a Catholic from southern Germany, so I grew up with a dual cultural background. There was a big difference between my grandparents' home in Denmark and my grandparents' home in Germany. Very quickly, I realized that I had to change my behavior to earn their affection. I adapted my behavior in southern Germany to get as much cake as possible, and I adapted my behavior in Denmark to get as much licorice as possible. Basically, there were two versions of me, and by understanding and navigating the different cultural norms between my grandparents, I profited from them as a child. What I noticed as I grew up and joined the workforce was that many large global companies were struggling with managing and bridging cultural differences within the workplace. My experience at one global company particularly stands out in my memory. My new job was at this company's headquarters. I left my previous job in an organization characterized by a high degree of diversity, and my family and I left the capital where we lived and moved to the other end of the country. Immediately, we noticed people's reactions to us big city people. We were the odd ones out. Having been used to the multicultural and diverse environment in the city, arriving at a company whose staff and culture I would characterize as homogeneous was a struggle for me, and in particular, my children. However, we were not the only ones who struggled to fit in. At that time, the company had relocated an Italian executive from one of its subsidiaries to the headquarters due to his remarkable results in Italy. Back then, he was one of the only non-Danes at the headquarters. However, I immediately saw the resistance he met simply because he was so culturally different. His outgoing way of approaching people was in stark contrast to the culture in the community, both within and outside of the company. I noticed this so clearly because I too felt this resistance. Needless to say, within a short while, he left to work for another global company, and so did I. The lack of inclusion at this Danish company, primarily due to a culture of sameness or homogeneity, meant that it became difficult to retain talented staff who did not fit the mold. The company was missing out. What I realized through this experience is that once you have worked in a highly culturally diverse and inclusive setting, you cannot go back. It's nothing personal. It's systemic. One of the challenges with bringing the conversation surrounding diversity and inclusivity to the fore is that it can lead to a blame game. Many men, in particular, can feel as though they are being blamed, even though they have not consciously contributed to the current situation. On many occasions, I have heard middle-aged white men say, "I'm not part of the diversity ambition. I am the one whose fault it is, and now I have to lose everything." This could not be further from the truth. In fact, in my experience, many men in this position want to change and make a difference. However, they do not want to be blamed in the process. Blame is not part of the diversity intelligence conversation. My aim is to support these men and encourage them to be actively involved in cultural transformations, because it is when you can mobilize these men that you start to see real progress. Attracting and retaining the best people is only one piece of the puzzle. It is by no means the only reason why organizations should care about inclusion. Another important aspect is sustainable governance, which is underpinned by diversity intelligence. Enhancing diversity intelligence is sustainable governance. In business, when you talk about sustainability, it always comes down to three areas: environmental, social, and governance, ESG. Diversity intelligence is an essential element of sustainable governance. More and more companies are being measured on how they are performing in relation to ESG and sustainability, which is why inclusion of diversity is becoming an increasingly pressing issue for many businesses. Overview of the book. In the first part of this book, we take a closer look at what diversity intelligence is and how it can be applied within organizations. Chapter 2 takes a deep dive into the business case for diversity intelligence, highlighting the strong financial incentives for choosing the right initiatives that will create a culture of inclusion. We close this part of the book by examining why more progress has not already been made in this area. Once we understand that background for diversity intelligence, we can look at how to move forward and create more inclusive businesses. Parts 2 and 3 are full of practical advice for creating the necessary cultural transformation where diversity intelligence goes far beyond the surface of an organization. I share best practice examples that have been gathered through the work of the Living Institute and our 17 years of experience helping companies in the field of inclusion and diversity. Among the topics I cover are the roles and responsibilities that allow diversity intelligence to succeed, including why synchronizing top management is such an essential part of the process. I share a simple tool to ensure your diversity intelligence strategy is focusing on the right initiatives, helping you to avoid the most common pitfalls that many businesses land in over and over again. I also talk about unconscious bias, cultural intelligence, and gender balance, all of which are huge topics on their own. Understanding these areas and how to navigate them plays a vital role in building a diverse and inclusive company. The final part of the book returns to some of the most important concepts and paints a picture of the future we are moving towards. Diversity and inclusion is no longer a nice to have. It is an essential building block for adaptable and resilient businesses that can navigate an increasingly uncertain world. Are you ready for change? If you are listening to this book, it is likely that you already understand the need for cultural transformation surrounding D&I within your organization. Maybe you have attempted to introduce D&I initiatives in the past and have seen them fail. Maybe you can see your competitors harnessing diversity and pulling ahead. Maybe you are new to this concept and want to make sure you get your D&I strategy right the first time. As founding partner and head of training at the Living Institute, I have encountered businesses in all of these situations and many more. We work with large global organizations where people often feel as though they are treading water with their D&I strategies, or even worse, slowly sinking. Trust me when I tell you that there is a path towards a brighter future, and I hope to guide your way towards it through this book. Whatever the practicalities of your specific situation, the reason you are here is the same. You are ready for a change. There are compelling arguments for enhancing diversity, but as you will soon learn, the real key to lasting cultural transformation is inclusion by applying diversity intelligence. James Baldwin, the American essayist, writing passionately about racial discrimination, said, "Not everything that is faced can be changed, but nothing can be changed until it is faced." Let's get started. Part 1. Introducing Diversity Intelligence. Definition: Diversity intelligence means the way in which any human system is designed to attract, motivate, engage, and retain people with diverse profiles who, through shared inclusion, can leverage their diversity to create better results. This book is centered around the concept of diversity intelligence as defined previously. But why introduce diversity intelligence as a concept now? Well, there is one main reason for this: a new conversation around diversity spurred on by the Black Lives Matter and hashtag MeToo movements that both target a systemic change. To see this more clearly, let us briefly take a look at the concept of diversity in its historical contexts. Origins of diversity. As a concept, diversity developed under different societal and historical contexts, primarily in the U.S. and Europe. In the U.S., diversity is often traced back to the Civil Rights Act signed in 1964, whereby it became illegal for employers to discriminate against workers, future or existing, based on identity markers such as race and ethnicity, their gender, nationality, or religious background. Much later, in 2008, the topic of diversity was renewed by focusing on the emerging tech industry in Silicon Valley and their diversity statistics, that is, the representation of women and people of color in various parts of these organizations. The disappointing results from these transparent investigations, as first reported by San Jose's Mercury News, helped to spark stakeholder pressure for these tech companies to continuously show their diversity numbers and document efforts to improve them, beginning perhaps most famously with Google publishing their diversity report in 2014. Meanwhile, in Europe, conversations about diversity centered around the issue of equality, and more specifically, gender equality and the integration, or in some cases, assimilation, of people from different ethnic and cultural backgrounds. Many were from former European colonies, while others were labor migrants or refugees from war-torn parts of the world. The point here is that in the European and U.S. historical contexts, the concept of diversity developed mainly because of an inability to integrate diversity into these societies in a meaningful and inclusive way to begin with. This brings us to the need for systemic change, which is what diversity intelligence targets. Recently, global movements such as Black Lives Matter and hashtag MeToo have irreversibly challenged our blindness to systemic prejudices and the power of privilege. It is no longer possible to talk only about individual behavior, the few rotten apples. What is needed is a much broader and more holistic approach that aims to change cultural systems. People interact within more or less structured systems, be they societies, organizations, or schools, for instance, and as such, we need to rethink the design of our systems to ensure physical and psychological safety, well-being, and fair opportunities for all. Diversity intelligence is systemic design. Building upon the insights from Black Lives Matter and hashtag MeToo, we will therefore refer to diversity intelligence as the way to achieve inclusion. As previously mentioned, diversity intelligence means to design a human system to attract, motivate, engage, and retain people with diverse profiles who, through shared inclusion, can leverage their diversity to create better results. Diversity intelligence will allow us to build up our capacity and courage to open our minds and hearts and strengthen relations to those who are not like us. In other words, we need diversity intelligence to ensure that we can achieve a balanced representation of people who reflect the societies and markets in which we operate, to allow us to use the immense power of differences to create the best possible solutions for our own benefit and the benefit of future generations. Let us say there is an organization whose competitive advantage is to attract the most talented specialists. As such, the organization cannot afford to overlook any potential talent due to their gender, age, nationality, skin color, or any other identity marker. Therefore, the organization decides to redesign every aspect of the employee life cycle with one goal in mind: the inclusion of all existing and future talent, irrespective of their different identities. Not only do they want to design the system to be attractive from the outside, they also want the system to make it easy for talented individuals to be motivated and feel engaged, thereby ensuring that once these talented people are in, they will not want to work anywhere else. However, what does it mean to design a system with diversity intelligence? Let me use an analogy to simplify this concept. Diversity intelligence, a walk in the park. Imagine a large city. As in most cities, this one has certain areas that are abandoned by most people and city officials. These are the kind of areas that are left to decay, making them attractive only as informal waste sites and spaces for criminal activity in the lure of darkness at night. The kind of areas that you avoid passing through if you can. They are certainly not places where you want to live. Now, imagine a city council that wants to transform this abandoned and decaying urban space into an attractive park for its citizens while offering housing opportunities to those who might have sought refuge there in the past. To do this, the council first has to get architects and urban landscapers to map out a design based on the existing area where the park will be located. To get the highest possible return on this investment, in a financial and social sense, they want the design to appeal to all the citizens who live in the city. Once the design of the park is in place, construction workers begin clearing the ground and laying new foundations for paths, playgrounds, and perhaps even space for open-air exercise equipment and art installations to be placed throughout. Gardeners begin tilling the ground, planting flowers and bushes, and trimming the trees. Perhaps the council decides to also implement accessible transportation to and from the park to make it as easy as possible for everyone to access the renewed space. Once all these things are in place, it will take little effort to encourage people to use the space as intended. No long, standard operating procedures are needed to explain the purpose of the park and how it should be used. It is simply built into the environment. Perhaps it is necessary to train people to oversee the park, maintaining it, and making sure everyone feels safe. But other than that, you can imagine how quickly the park could be filled with people from all over the city who run and exercise there, who eat their lunch on benches, have picnics on the grass and play with their children. Perhaps even outsiders such as tourists will be attracted to the park to view the art installations or simply escape the crowded streets of the city. This park now has a design that attracts, motivates, engages, and retains as many different people as possible. This is what I mean by a diversity intelligent design. In this book, I am taking you on a walk in this metaphorical park. I will show you how you can design the architecture in your organization, highlighting what you need to keep in mind to attract, motivate, engage, and retain as many people as possible, no matter who they are. I will also show you what you can do to educate those who are responsible for managing this diversity intelligent system and what they need to do to constantly sustain and update it by adjusting to the people within it. With this definition in mind, diversity intelligence does not have to be an insurmountable task that takes decades to accomplish. In fact, by following the guidelines laid out in this book, implementing a diversity intelligent system is really something of a walk in the park. Diversity intelligence is the path to inclusion. In the last decade, we have seen a multitude of studies published, many of which you will become familiar with in this book, that show time and again that simply increasing the representation of people from so-called diverse backgrounds, meaning, in a somewhat outdated sense, minorities of all kinds, is not enough. In fact, without a culture of inclusion, these diversity efforts will fail. Inclusion is the end goal, the magic pill for any organization. At the Living Institute, we have developed a statistically valid method to measure whether a system is diversity intelligent or not. Our key metric is inclusion. In other words, the purpose of designing a diversity intelligent system is that it results in a shared sense of inclusion. We know from our analysis and surveys measuring the level of inclusion in global companies that, in general, there are two key characteristics of inclusion. One, do people feel like they belong within the organization or their team, that is, the system? Two, do people experience fair and equal career opportunities regardless of the unique and different skills and competencies they contribute? Combined, people's sense and experiences of belonging and fair opportunities, also referred to as equity, give us an indication of the level of inclusion. As it turns out, the more an organization implements the guidelines of diversity intelligence as listed in this book, the higher their overall inclusion score. As such, diversity intelligence is the roadmap to inclusion. Before I take you through the different guidelines for achieving diversity intelligence, let us first examine what it looks like when an organization is not designed with diversity intelligence in mind. Secondly, we will discover why inclusion and diversity intelligence matter from a business perspective, including why they are increasingly described as business critical. Chapter 1. A shift in mindset. Representation is not a marker of inclusion. At the Living Institute, we encourage all of our clients to view inclusion as the end goal rather than diversity. This distinction is important because if you can create a culture of inclusion, you can welcome and include everyone. Diversity without inclusion is a terrible idea for the people you hire in and for your company. People are able to feel whether an environment is inclusive. In fact, most of us have this ability. We might not always be able to point to the specific factors that make a culture or environment feel as though it is inclusive or not, but on a subconscious level, we are able to sense whether somewhere, in this case a business, has a high or low degree of inclusion. While research shows us that it does matter that diversity is visible in a company setting, few people, who generally are considered to be minority group members, prefer to be the token of diversity. Why? Because they want to feel like they are part of the group and be treated the same as everyone else, just as we all do. Making diversity work for everyone. We're going to begin by looking back 17 years to the early days of the Living Institute and a Danish cleaning company we worked with at that time. When you looked at the lowest levels of that company's hierarchy, there were no Danes working among the cleaning staff. These jobs were held entirely by immigrant workers. However, as soon as you looked even one step higher, all you would see were Danes. The managers in charge of the cleaning teams were Danish. Their managers were Danish, and so on, all the way to the top. The Living Institute was invited to deliver a workshop about cultural intelligence to this first tier of managers, because at this time, the company was struggling to recruit cleaners of certain nationalities. It transpired that if a manager had a conflict with one person from a particular community, that entire community would refuse to work for this company. Imagine, for example, that a manager had a conflict with a Somali cleaner, and all of a sudden, this company could not recruit any cleaners from the Somali community. The managers towards the top of the hierarchy were concerned that they might see one community after another blacklisting their company, leaving them with a smaller and smaller pool of people from which to recruit. When we came in to deliver our workshop, we were tasked with getting the teams of managers further down the hierarchy to see working with non-Danes as a positive. At the beginning of the workshop, we asked everyone to share their experiences of working with people from all over the world, while we wrote all the statements on a flip chart for everyone to see. Among the stories we heard were that the cleaners went on holiday and never came back, that many prayed most of the time, that some did not respect female superiors, that most of them did not understand work instructions, or they did not want to understand instructions, someone said. The them and us rhetoric was saturating the room. We were filling up the flip chart with a long list of complaints. Next, we flipped to a clean sheet of paper and asked the participants what was good about working with non-Danes, and you could hear a pin drop. Finally, someone said, "I really look forward to when the Thai women in my team bring food to work, because Thai food tastes so goddamn good." A female participant said, "When I had my first child and came back from maternity leave, some of the women brought me bags full of baby stuff, and one had baked a cake to celebrate the event. I was very touched by it." One person said, "I had the best holiday ever with my family last summer. One of the guys on my team invited us to stay in his family's house in the mountains in Bosnia. It was fabulous, with a swimming pool and all. Our kids loved it. People were warm and welcoming, and we became friends with some of his neighbors." All of a sudden, the room was filled with more and more positive stories, from the Moroccan cleaner who brought a present to someone's house for their son's birthday, to invitations to be the guest of honor at lavish weddings. As the managers shared more and more examples of positive experiences of working with non-Danes, it became apparent that what made all the difference was not how the non-Danes were different, but rather the feeling of caring for one another and sharing more than their professional roles dictated. What made the difference to these managers were their experiences of being included. Snapping my fingers. As the talk died down, I addressed this group of 20 to 25 people and said, "Okay, what if I told you that I had the authority to just snap my fingers, and that would mean that when you came into work tomorrow, you'd only be working with Danes, people just like you. Would you want me to snap my fingers?" After an awkward moment, all I heard were statements like, "No, don't do it." I asked, "Why? If I snap my fingers, all these problems and complaints you shared on the 7 flip charts earlier would disappear. Everything would be so much easier." The responses included, "I actually love the fact that we're not the same." And, "I find it very intriguing to learn how they're different from me." I said, "But is there no turning back? 10 years ago, you were all cleaners in homogeneous Danish teams. Don't you want to go back to those days?" The reply was, "No, thinking about it, this is actually so much better." A them and us syndrome had clouded all the positive sides of working with people with a different cultural background to their own. When confronted with the risk of losing the daily encounters with their non-Danish colleagues, it dawned on everyone in the room how much they would lose. Inclusion is addictive. Even with all the complexities of diversity, the pitfalls and the conflict, we seldom meet anyone who, given the choice, says they wish their organization would become 100% homogeneous again. The thing is, you become addicted to inclusion. Without a diversity intelligent mindset, you get stuck in the sameness trap, convincing yourself and others that working with people who are just like you is much better. I'm an ethnic minority, female and lesbian. I represent diversity in almost every way. What I need is not to be highlighted as the example of diversity in our company. What I need are fair and equal opportunities and good inclusive leadership. Female responded to an inclusion survey. Why diversity is a sensitive issue? We are moving towards greater diversity more quickly than ever before, but our minds may not always be traveling as fast as reality. In short, some of us are struggling to keep up with the pace of change, from homogeneity as the norm to diversity as the norm. Even though, when you think of all the invisible diversity parameters, it would be easy to argue that diversity, in some sense, is already the norm. Diversity is often considered a sensitive topic. There are many reasons for this, but one of the most integral is that many of us are becoming more and more aware of a lack of diversity in many areas, and at the same time, do not know how to change it. Our communities are becoming much more diverse, so we are seeing greater diversity reflected in the world around us. In addition, there have been several pivotal movements that have catapulted diversity, and particularly inequality, into the global spotlight. In terms of shining a light on the lack of gender equality within organizations, societies, and families, the hashtag MeToo movement has been incredibly powerful. It showed us how big that gender imbalance really is. Similarly, the Black Lives Matter movement has highlighted the scale of racism within societies around the world. It gained momentum after the unbearable and reprehensible death of George Floyd in the U.S., and months later, it had become a truly global movement. The global attention on diversity and representation has caused societies and organizations to face the reality that many, if not most, social systems are designed to favor and promote those who are already in power. Now, because of these uprisings, we have to ask ourselves, what are we doing to ensure fair and equal opportunities for all? Have we created a culture where everyone can thrive and contribute with their unique and authentic selves? This feeling of not knowing what to do around a lack of diversity is not just a personal problem. It is one that a great number of organizations around the world are grappling with. I would say that the majority of Fortune 500 companies aim to have more females in top management positions, but many simply do not know how to achieve this. In fact, despite this realization, in most companies, it is a real struggle for women to advance to top executive level. At the same time, our inclusion surveys and other studies show that women are more ambitious than men, while companies lose significant sums of money by not having women in top management positions. The issue is incredibly complex, both in terms of the reasons why it is the way it is, and also in terms of why we often cannot make a change even if we want to. It is a matter of perception. How included we feel in a particular organization comes down to our own personal identity. We see this all the time when we field inclusion surveys in large companies. There are always groups who feel less included than others. And I hate to say it, but in most organizations, it is usually white, middle-aged male respondents who say they feel highly included. When we compare their answers to the survey to those given by women of color.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.